Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to the Pilgrim Congregational United Church of Christ in Oak Park. My name is Harriet Dart, and I will be your liturgist this morning. I hear you're anxious to use some of the sound makers. You'll have the opportunity after the call to worship. I bring you greetings from your brothers and sisters across the United Church of Christ who gathered in Baltimore for the 31st General Synod of the United Church of Christ, where we envision a just world for all. We are delighted that you are celebrating worship with us this morning. So please rise in body or spirit to share this responsive call to worship. People of God, come gather here to praise our God for the one who so delighted in creating all that is abides with us and within us today.
Our hearts are filled with gladness.
Let us delight in this community and the warm and loving relationships that grow within it.
Our hearts are filled with gladness.
Let us remember Christ, who loved sharing stories and bringing healing and wholeness to all he encountered.
Our hearts are filled with gladness.
Let us feel the embracing goodness of the Spirit who leads us toward a future of justice and joy.
Our hearts are filled with gladness.
Come, let us worship our God.
Well, here we are on this morning, on this Sunday morning with the sun shining and the heat rising and the balloons floating to remind us that we can delight. We can delight in that which is good in our lives, in our faith community, in our wider community, and throughout the world, because there is so much that is good. Sometimes we get in our own way of seeing what is good. I invite you into prayer. God of grace, there are times when we turn away from joy, and in doing so, we separate ourselves from you. In a spirit of contrition and deep mindfulness, we come to you with our prayers of confession. We regret that in the busyness of everyday life, we forget to look for everyday blessings and celebrate them. We acknowledge there are times when we get in our own way. We build roadblocks on paths we know would lead to happiness and railroad others who would invite us into loving and joyful relationships. We flabbergast ourselves at our ability to choose misery over gladness. We admit there are times we compare ourselves to others and become discouraged. We confess there are times we deflate other people's joy. We fall into the folly of believing we have to earn your grace by hard work and self-deprecation. We make silly choices and forget to laugh at them. Help us to accept your grace. Let us be in silent prayer.
This morning's scripture reading comes from Genesis chapter 24, various versions. Jennifer Coleman and I will be reading responsibly. In today's Hebrew text, Sarah has died and Abraham is near the end of his life. He does not want Isaac to marry a Canaanite. His descendants are to fulfill God's promise to be from Sarah's lineage. So Abraham sends his trusted servant, yet unnamed, to Nahor's household to look for a suitable wife for Isaac. You are invited into the servant's narrative, and Jennifer will read the reflection, perhaps, of Rebecca's thoughts. Please listen for this servant's affection for Abraham, his connection with God, and his delight in encountering Rebecca and her response to him. The union of Isaac and Rebecca is a great love story. The biblical narrative tells us that Isaac loved Rebecca from the moment he saw her. And unlike other patriarchs of Israel, Isaac had no other wife than Rebecca. Hear these words from the Hebrew Bible. So he said, I am Abraham's servant. The Lord has greatly blessed my master, and he has become wealthy. He has given him flocks and herds, silver and gold, male and female slaves, camels and donkeys. And Sarah, my master's wife, bore a son to my master when she was old. And he has given him all that he has. My master made me swear, saying, you shall not take a wife for my son from the daughters of the Canaanites in whose land I live, but you shall go to my father's house, to my kindred, and get a wife for my son. I came today to the spring and said, O Lord, my God, the master of Abraham, if you will only make successful the way I am going, I am standing here by the spring of water. Let the young woman who comes out to draw, to whom I shall say, please, give me a little water from your jar to drink. And this woman will reply, drink, and I will draw for your camels also. Let her be the woman whom the Lord has appointed to be my master's son, for my master's son. Before I had finished speaking in my heart, there was Rebecca coming out with a water jar on her shoulder, and she went down to the spring and drew. I said to her, please, let me drink.
I had no idea that this man was anyone's servant, much less that the one who sent him was kin. All I saw was a man standing by the spring from which we always drew water. He looked as though he had been traveling long, and the sun had worn down on him. All I heard was the simple request of a drink. He didn't order me to provide it. He asked, is not the water free? Is hospitality a gift, not a burden?
From the scripture, she quickly let down her jar from her shoulder and said, drink, and I will also water your camels. So I drank, and she also watered the camels.
Some wondered later why I, not he, watered his animals. My family has often said that the animals who bear the burden of the day need water as much as any of us. And as long as he had journeyed, I felt he should have some time to rest as he enjoyed the water quenching his thirst. That is, after all, a hospitable thing to do.
Then I asked her, whose daughter are you? She said, the daughter of Bethuel, Nahor's son, whom Milcah bore to him. So I put the ring on her nose and the bracelets on her arms.
Dear me, you must be wondering why I want a stranger with all that jewelry on me. But please remember, the words of the story you are hearing are the servants later recounting to my father and brother, and thus do not tell the whole of our encounter. It was not just that he learned who I was. He told me he was the servant of Abraham, was kin to me, and I trusted the gifts he brought since the jewelry was a sign of God's blessing on the servant.
Then I bowed my head and worshiped the Lord, and blessed the Lord, the God of my master Abraham, who had led me by the right way to obtain the daughter of my master's kinsman for his son. Now then, if you will deal loyally and truly with my master, tell me, he said to Rebecca, and if not, tell me, so that I may turn either to the right hand or to the left. And they called Rebecca and said to her, will you go with this man? She said, I will.
What I most respected in that moment was the choice afforded to me. Abraham's servant did not command me to return with him to Isaac. My father and brother did not make the decision for me. They asked if it would be my will, and I said, I will. Two paths were placed before me that day, go with the servant or remain with my family. Both paths offered me the opportunity to live in faithfulness to God. I was left to choose my own path.
So they went away. They sent away their sister Rebecca and her nurse, along with Abraham's servant and his men. And they blessed Rebecca and said to her, may you, our sister, become thousands of myriads. May your offspring gain possession of the gates of their foes. Then Rebecca and her maids rose up, mounted the camels, and followed the man. Thus the servant took Rebecca and went his way.
Farewells, even when chosen, even when full of hope, bring parting. So like Sarah and Abraham, whose servant came to me, I chose to leave. I left, trusting in our God, who invites not only our welcoming of others, but our welcoming of the journey before us, regardless of the paths we choose.
Now Isaac had come from Beer Hellaboy and was settled in the Negev. Isaac went out in the evening to walk in the field, and looking up, he saw the camels coming, and Rebekah looked up. And when she saw Isaac, she slipped quickly from the camel and said to the servant, who is that man over there walking in the field to meet us? The servant said, it is my master. So she took her veil and covered herself. And the servant told Isaac all the things that he had done. Then Isaac brought her into his mother Sarah's tent. He took Rebecca, and she became his wife, and he loved her. So Isaac was comforted after his mother's death. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
seasons of the Spirit, takes this text that we have today, which we could go in 18 different directions with, and I, for one, could probably have a fit, but I won't, and reminds us to delight, right? If we walk into another church, and there's a whole lot of stuff going on that's hard stuff, and yet the voices in this church are going, thank you, God, thank you, Jesus, hallelujah, I am blessed by all I've been given. Wow. It's good to be reminded that there's a lot to delight in. There are so many things to delight in. And so, I'm going to do a little picking and choosing with the story we have this morning, so that I too can delight in this text, and I think that it won't do damage to the text. I do invite you sometime this week to pick up your Bible and read all of chapter 24. It's an abbreviated romance novel from 3,000 years ago, with all of the social context and cultural expectations that were part of that world, and in fact, are still part of our world. Those of us in this country like to pretend it isn't here. It is. So a couple things that speak to me from this text, the part that we read today, the part that Harriet read today, and you'll notice that it wasn't Jennifer Burney who was doing Rebecca's part, it was Jennifer Coleman. I apologize for that error. But now you know, here's Jennifer Coleman, who will read and doesn't know. So, right from the get-go in our text, we hear that this is the story of a servant. It's not one of the main characters. It's a trusted servant. So already we're hearing the story from someone who otherwise wouldn't be heard from. And this is the Hebrew text, right? So we have all these imaginations about what did or didn't happen during that time. The reality is that we can find almost anything in both the Hebrew text and the New Testament. So the servant is the one who is sent, the trusted servant, to do the work that Abraham needs him to do. And shortly after we discover it's a servant that we're hearing about, the servant prays. The servant is praying for guidance, to be able to fulfill the wish of his master, to find a wife for the master's son. Find a wife among the kinfolk who live far away from where Abraham and Sarah and Isaac are. He prays. He trusts God enough to lift this requirement, this journey he's been sent on, this request from his master. He trusts God enough to pray to him, to help him fulfill. And then we have Rebecca arriving on the scene. And Rebecca is willing to be hospitable in a time when, well, you know, there probably aren't too many other people around, and it probably could have been scary. And it's likely that the servant and his men and all the livestock they brought and all of the wealth they brought with them could have been overpowered. And yet she speaks to him, and when he says, please give me something to drink, she says, of course, and I will also give water to you guys. It is a romantic story, isn't it? It allows us to view this place, this time, with a different lens. It allows us to put our hopes and dreams in there. It allows us to delight in human interaction, to take the story and let it be our own story. To take the story and learn something. To take the story and allow ourselves to delight. She provides water both to the servant who is unnamed. A speaking part for an unnamed servant. It happens, but not often. And they interact with each other, and then, as happens in that culture, the men talk to each other. And while our story is presented today as if Rebecca is the one who is deciding, the reality is it wasn't. She wasn't deciding if she would go. She was deciding when she would go. And even that is a big deal. Even that can be something to delight in. Part of the reason I'm suggesting you read the whole text is it really is a beautiful piece. There are many things that I delight in. I delight in this faith community. I delight in your openness to what's going on in the world, what's going on inside of you, what's happening for us as a faith community, and how we might be more faithful. Even more faithful. I delight in this faith. You all know, because you've heard more than once, and I hope no one's heard it, how I delight in my grandchildren and my children and my husband. I am blessed. And they are a blessing. Yesterday, the worship planning committee got together to talk about worship for the fall months. And, you know, it's an interesting thing when you bring together, I think yesterday we had 12, we had a total of 14, two people couldn't be with us. That's a big number, right? And everybody's got their assignments about which piece they're going to look at, what they're going to think about. And the ideas and the energy that were in the room, for me, were very stimulating. Claudia Dibbis, who chairs Worship in the Arts at Boston College. She and I were talking this morning, because you know, she's there as well, how it was so, I mean, the things that one person would say would trigger something that someone else was thinking, or connect with something that someone else was thinking. And it was just this really wonderful gift. I delight in worship. After worship today, I'm going to get in my car and I'm going to drive to Iowa City. It's something that I do, that I have done almost every summer since 2009. I usually participate in a workshop at the Iowa Summer Writing Festival. Now, some of you may be aware of the Iowa Writers Workshop. That's not this. It benefits from having the Iowa Writers Workshop being on that campus, but this is, the way this works is that from the middle of June until the end of July, every week and every weekend, they are offering 12 to 15 different workshops, and none of them are repeated throughout that 6-week period. And so when they send information out about what they're offering, if you're smart, or have done this a number of times, you know, as soon as it comes out, we want to look to see what they're offering and see which one you want, and then you sign right up. If you sign up and you pay, and you're among the first 12 people, you're in. I'm in for my workshop. It's an environment that's focused on writing. It's a delight to me. There are, I mean, people are there working on plays, people are there working on novels, people are there working on short stories, people are there working on all kinds of things. They're there to write, right? The whole thing is set up to focus on writing. So this is what will happen. At 6:30 tonight, I will gather with everyone else, and they will feed us what they refer to as a light meal. It's a feast. I mean, You don't have to think, oh, where am I going to stop for food after this? No. You're going to go home full. And then they have an orientation to help people know where they are and what they're doing. And then you begin your first session in class. You go to where your class meets. And my guess is we won't spend more than half an hour or an hour there. It won't be very long. But we get started. We get to meet each other, know what's coming up. And then for the rest of the week, Monday through Friday, we will meet from 2 to 5 each day. At 11 o'clock every morning, they will have a lecture on writing, or they'll have people reading some of their writing. Every evening, there's an opportunity to go hear some author speak about what they've written. It is an environment that is focused on writing. It is a delight. The light. I am so grateful to be able to do this thing. It's a delight. Each of us has things that delight us. And sometimes, we let all the other stuff kind of get in the way of experiencing that delight. Maybe it takes too much to get organized enough to be gone for a week to actually start delighting in the thing you're going to be doing for that week. You know how it is when you go on vacation? Oh no, I've got to do this, I've got to do that, I've got to do this. You should have seen me packing. Oh. But I'm making it. I'm so grateful to Seasons of the Spirit for taking this story, this romance, and allowing us to delight. Rebecca says, yes, I will go now. And she goes with the servant and the servant's men. And they travel for many, many, many miles. And as they're approaching the place where Isaac now resides, he's out walking in the field. Rebecca notices him. She dismounts from the camel, asks the servant who this is, and he tells her, so she covers herself. And Isaac takes her into the tent of his mother, who is now dead. And they loved each other. Isaac loved Rebecca. And the scripture wasn't afraid to say it. How delightful. I hope that this day you will be reminded of something that delights you, and you can dwell in that delight. Amen.